All right, this is Susan Haynes, and this is my last example from this set of examples of state transition diagrams and state transition tables being used to model important tasks in computer science, important things in computer science. So the last example I want to give you is one that you are going to see over and over again and will become very natural way because it explains how tasks, the states of tasks in a multitasking environment. So the operating system is charged with managing the CPU, and there may be several tasks that the CPU is having to control, and in a single CPU physical situation, only one task at a time can be given the CPU. So it's the operating system's task to make sure there are no collisions on the CPU. And the way this is done is by having each state be in a particular task, and the transition of those by having each task be in a particular state, and the transition of those states follow very simple rules of state transition, and the operating system is in charge of keeping track of the states that each task is in, so that only one state at a only one task at a time will be given the CPU. So if I have several tasks in this multitasking environment, each task is going to be in a state, which is described by this state transition diagram. So a task will enter the system, change this to black. So a task will enter the system right here, and the initial state is the ready state. And this is a simplified state transition diagram for tasks, but it's good enough, certainly good enough to get the feel for what's going on in a multitasking environment. When the CPU is ready to make give the CPU to a particular task, it'll choose that task that is in the ready state. There may be several tasks in the ready state. The operating system will pick one to give to the CPU, and it will transition then the state of that task from ready to running. And what causes that transition is not an input, it's the execution of some part of the operating system. So I'm going to just label this with a description of what's going on. The OS schedules the task to run. Okay, now in a multitasking environment, what will typically happen is that the task that is in the running state often will be allowed to run for a slice of time, and then a different task will be given the CPU. That ensures a notion of fairness, so that if a task has a really long execution time, all the other tasks are not completely shut out of running on the CPU. So if we're in that kind of a situation, then a typical kind of scheduling environment to do that is called round robin. There are others, many others, but round robin is probably the easiest. When a task is in the run state and it completes its fair share of time, the operating system will move that task back into the ready state. So when that happens, the operating system is going to schedule a different task. To run. Okay, again, this, what I'm labeling here is not input, this is a description of what has occurred to cause the transition of a state. Okay, so a task enters the system in the ready state when it is given to the CPU, or equivalently, when the CPU is given to it, it transitions to the run state. Now, often a task will request a resource. It might request, access to the network card, or it might request that it be put to sleep for some amount of time. And that requesting of the resource will move the task out of the run state into a third state, which we call blocked. And the task remains in this blocked state until the resource becomes available and the resource is assigned to this task. So what causes this transition from run to block is the task requests a resource. I need access to the network card. Okay, so the operating system says, okay, you need access to the network card. I'm going to block you until that resource is available. Okay, it's a resource from OS. Just to make clear, it's that the OS is what's doing this assignment of state to the tasks. Okay, when that resource becomes available, the OS recognizes that, and the OS grants the resource to the task. The task then goes back into the ready state. Okay, so this is the state transition diagram for a multitasking environment. And so let me do the state transition table just to be complete here. Let's see, we have ready, running, and blocked. And then our new state, I better make sure I have enough room to label what causes the transition. Our new state right here. Okay, so what can cause the transition from ready? I can go to run, and that's the only transition I'm allowed to have. So I'm going to write down here scheduler to indicate there's a scheduler that causes that. So we can move to run based on what the scheduler says. Okay, to go from ready, I cannot go anywhere else out of the ready state. From the run state, I can go to block state by request resource. Resource request. Okay, that's obviously not for the ready state. For the run, if I'm in the run state, I can go back to the block state. If I request the resource, if the scheduler is running, then I go back from run to ready state. So the scheduler running, let me underline that in red so that you can see that. The OS scheduler has to run right here to cause this to happen. Okay, so to go from run to ready, the OS scheduler is running. Okay, and then when I'm in the block state, if the resource is granted, grant request, I'm in the block state and I'm granted the request, then I move into the ready state. There's no other way of getting out of the block state. Okay, ready cannot go ready. There's no way to go from ready to blocked directly. That's the standard way of looking at this. To go from run, I can go from run to ready or run to blocked. Run can go to ready, run can go to blocked. Block, the only thing I can go to is the ready state, and the only way that'll happen is if the operating system grants a resource. All right, so this is my last example demonstrating the general usefulness of state transitions for understanding different things in computer science. It's very useful for a number of different things. And in fact, if you go back and you look at your flow charts and rethink what's going on in that flow chart, that is actually very close to a state transition diagram itself. So there you go. End of introduction to state transition diagrams.